Okay, everyone. I think we're going to get started. Attention.
Kathy.
Thank you.
There you go.
Thank you, Ben. Thank you so much, everyone, for being here tonight for our 9th annual Ludi T. Benjamin Jr. Distinguished Lecture in the History of Psychology. We're glad to have you here. And for those of you who are coming in from out of town, welcome to Akron. So as some of you know, this lecture honors Dr. Ludi T. Benjamin Jr., known to many of you as Ben. Dr. Benjamin is known internationally as an outstanding teacher, scholar, and researcher. Dr. Benjamin's work in the history of psychology has helped us understand everything from the history of teaching machines to popular understandings of science to the origins of clinical psychology in the United States. He is perhaps one of the most knowledgeable historians of psychology that I know. Since his first visit to the archives of the history of American psychology in 1975, Ben has always understood the importance of our mission, and he has always put his considerable skills and knowledge, which includes just an amazing talent for storytelling, to work really for us at the archives. Nearly 5 decades later, we continue to be honored to call Ben and Priscilla our friends, and it's truly our honor to hold this lecture every year in your honor, Ben. Now, I think most of you here in this room tonight also know that, I don't even need to say this, at the Cummings Center for the History of Psychology, we have probably the best team, the best group of faculty and staff across the entire campus of the University of Akron. I don't think anyone in this room would argue with that. So I just want to acknowledge our entire staff who are here tonight. Jennifer Bazaar, John Endres, Emily Gaynor, Dorothy Gruich, Jody Cairns, Rhonda Reinhart, Lizette Royer-Barton, Tony Pankush, and Fran Ugalde. Thank you so much for everything you all did tonight to make this event happen, but even more so, all the work that you do, that we all do together every day to preserve and share psychology's history with such a broad audience. Thank you. Tonight in our audience, we also have a whole bunch of our student assistants. We couldn't do anything that we do without them. So when you come into the National Museum of Psychology, you will be greeted by the friendly face of one of our student assistants. The exhibits that we put on, the collections that we process, everything that we do happens because of you. We couldn't do it without you. Thank you for your contributions every day. We have with us tonight our former director, our director emeritus, Dr. David Baker. Welcome back to Akron, Dave. You have a following. Also, we are glad to have with us tonight most of the members of the Cummings Center advisory board. So every year that we hold this lecture, we actually spend the whole day in a board meeting prior to this. It's a long day, rewarding, but long. So I want to say thank you to our Cummings Center Advisory Board. Most of them are with us tonight. We have Stephanie Foley, Christopher Green, Ken Keith, Robert Lohman, Alexandra Rutherford, and Andrew Winston. We have a few folks missing. Rob Wozniak, Dot Cummings, and Florence Denmark are not with us tonight. But we are glad to have with us representatives from the Cummings family and the Cummings Foundation, Andrew Cummings and Julie Helberg. Thank you for being here. Andrew is actually, you know, the Cummings Center for the History of Psychology is named for Dorothy and Nicholas Cummings. And so we're glad to have Andrew, their son, and the chair of the Cummings Foundation for Behavioral Health with us tonight, and Brett Sabatini, who is the president of the foundation. Your continued commitment to us is really appreciated. I also want to give a special welcome to the team from PEGS Foundation, who is with us tonight. Many members of the PEGS Foundation and the PEGS Foundation larger family, Rick Keller, Victoria Romanda, Tom Craig. We also have with us Penny Fries, and Suzanne Morgan Kempton. Thank you so much for being here. And John Pavloff, I'm sorry, a new member of the foundation as well. We, you know, when we first started out, it was really Peg's Foundation, which was then called the Margaret Clark Morgan Foundation, that helped us get off the ground and really helped, believed in us when we didn't really have a solid thing to look at yet, right? And that's really important. That really helped us become who we are. So today we continue to try to do what we can to help realize Peg Morgan's vision of thinking better to improve the lives of people with serious mental illness. We also, I should say, we also strive to someday make this event as grand as the Morgan Impact Awards. So next year we're gonna get a red carpet and we're gonna steal Victoria for like 2 weeks. Finally, thank you to everyone who gave generously to support this event. With special thanks to our organizational sponsor this year, the Ohio Psychological Association. Without further ado, it is my pleasure to introduce tonight's guest speaker, Dr. Rosie Phillips-Davis. Dr. Davis is a professor of counseling psychology at the University of Memphis, where she has also served as the vice president for student affairs and the director of the Center for Student Development. Dr. Davis served as the 2019 president of the American Psychological Association, where she focused on the psychological needs of people living in deep poverty. She is also a former president of the International Association of Counseling Center Service. And I think this is one of the coolest things she's done. She is the co-founder of the American Psychological Association's National Multicultural Conference and Summit. Dr. Davis is the author of numerous articles and book chapters on career counseling, and she has co-edited 2 books. She is the recipient of way more awards than I can name tonight, so I will just name a few. The Janet E. Helms Award for Mentoring and Professional Psychology. The Janet E. Helms Award for Mentoring and Scholarship, and the Distinguished Service Award to the profession from the American Board of Professional Psychology. In 2021, she received the Leona Tyler Award, which is the most prestigious award given by the Society of Counseling Psychology. And this award recognized her lifetime of significant and sustained contributions to the field of counseling psychology. In addition to her contributions to her campus, and to the larger field of psychology, she has also shown a strong connection to and care for her local community. She is a founding board member of the Women's Foundation for Greater Memphis, whose mission is to help women break the cycle of poverty through philanthropy, leadership, and collaboration. It's a lot of spaces and places to give. And in all of these spaces and places, Dr. Davis is known for her commitment to social justice and equity, her kind and humble demeanor, and her impactful leadership. It is our great honor to have her here with us tonight. So please help me give a very warm welcome to Dr. Rosie Phillips-Davis.
Well, thank you, Kathy. And, you know, it's the first time I've given a talk named after somebody sitting in the room. Usually they're dead. And actually, Ben, the only reason I have that long list of stuff is because I'm right behind you. or not, I might be in front of you.
I keep looking every year to get the door.
I know, yeah, exactly. But as long as you can see it, you're good. Well, it is my pleasure to be here with you. And when I looked at the title again, I said, oh, okay, I suppose I should explain this title. So how many of you heard that we live to be 3 score and 10? Anybody ever heard that? Oh, so the boomers have. Well, there's a thing about that we're promised 70 years to live. And so the way I see my life is chapter 1 from about 1 to 35, and chapter 2 is 36 to 70. So if I'm in chapter 3, y'all know I could pass 70. So chapter 3. So, oh, you like that? You like it? Yeah. So we're in chapter 3. We're in chapter 3. Thank you all for coming. My great friends who are here. People I've known in the profession from when we were probably in our 30s. It's great. That's great. I'm glad you're here. So what I'm going to do tonight is tell you a story. The story will take a good little while. And then I'm going to do that academic thing and show you a bunch of PowerPoint slides. Now, my understanding is that you get to ask me questions. So, Kathy, your charge is if I'm still going, when I'm gone to 45 minutes, you told me to go to 50. But if I'm still going at 45, please wave your hand. If I stop before that, after I know all of you've had drinks, you'll probably be glad. But so first of all, do you all know what a shotgun house is? Anybody? Oh, why, I got a black woman not raising her hand. She said, you, yes, ma'am. Said, you must not be from the South. Okay, so you got to go home and ask them, what is a shotgun house? So what a shotgun house is the house where the room, in the North, what I learned is that people call it railroad cars. You know, they write one behind the other. The saddest thing I ever heard was from, I was talking with some 8-year-olds. They may have been 8 to 12. And I said, do you know what a shotgun house is? And one said, I don't know what a shotgun house is, but I know what a shotgun is. Yeah, that's the way I felt about it. They call it a shotgun house because you could stand in the at the front door and shoot the gun and it'd go straight out the back door. Okay. That's the shotgun house. Okay. Just so that you know. So here we go. So she lived in a 4-room shotgun house with 8 of her 11 siblings. That meant in this little dull gray shedding paint-colored house. The first room was the living room. The second room was where Madea, her mother, and Jake, her father, slept. Then came the third room where all the children slept, followed by the kitchen with a small bathroom attached. The rooms were about 10 by 10 or maybe 12 by 12. They had linoleum floors that the family put down, or wooden floors that if you ran across them too quickly, you might get a splinter in your foot. Self-applied wallpaper, cheap furniture, including a couch in the living room that grew lumpy from Rosie choosing to sleep there after she tired of sleeping in beds where she might awaken to a foot in her mouth, sleeping with her sisters, 2 or 3 at the foot of the bed, 2 or 3 at the head of the bed. Or she might awaken to a large, warm, wet spot when one of the children had an accident. Plus, Rosie just liked to stay up late watching TV when they finally got a television when she was about 10 years old. When she was in 7th grade, she did her own hair. Because of over Madea's objection, she let one of her sisters cut her bangs. And so Rosie had to do her own hair, and she periodically burned plugs out of her hair, which she used 2 hot straightening combs and curlers to smooth and fix her nappy hair. Rosie was dark-skinned, and on her way to school, it was usual for children to shout out, "You so black and ugly." Then they just laughed. Well, maybe she was black and ugly. She had short, nappy hair in a world that called good hair long and straight like that on white folk. She had dark skin in a world that said, if you're light, you're all right, and if you're black, get back. She was shy, wore old ill-fitting clothes, shoes with run-over heels that had cardboard in the bottom to protect her feet from the concrete when there was a hole in the sole of the only pair of shoes she owned. And I guess a too big pair of glasses would have completed the outfit, but she never had her eyes examined until she was 18 years old. She felt badly about herself because she believed the taunts, and sometimes a dark cloud hung over her head. The family took bath in the same tin tub that they rinsed the clothes in and hung them out in the back dirt yard on a clothesline that was shared with the neighbors. Majil was creative about making sure the children had enough to eat. She made large pot of beans and cooked cornbread, and she seasoned the beans with fat back that was only enough for Jake to have a piece. Sometimes when Jake's garbage man's salary would not stretch far enough, Majil had to be creative with that piece of meat. So she fried the meat and make gravy, and the children would eat gravy and cornbread, saving the meat for tomorrow's gravy. So what happens to a severely poor kid like Rosie? Now, give an example of severely poor. If you think 1968, when Martin Luther King came to Memphis, Tennessee, to fight for the garbage workers for Rose's dad, poverty was $6,000 a year for a family of four, two adults, two children. Rosie's family most of the time had 8 to 9 children and two adults living on under $3,000 a year. So how did the family get to this place? How did their travels and their circumstances affect that little girl, Rosie? And I'll talk about it in the third person throughout because somehow it just seems right talking about it in the third person. So as we journey a little bit further back to see how, what happened in that early stage from the cradle, were any of you poor? Do you know any poor people? How was it in your childhood? One of the things I know is that psychologists rarely see poor people. 90% of psychologists never see a poor person. The other thing that I wonder about Rosie is how did her race and gender intersect with poverty? And one of the things I don't pretend to know is that I have answers to those questions. But I do have questions and I do have wonder. And I hope you will wonder too. And by the time we end our time together, you will have some answers about who you are and what is the difference you want to make in the world. So I remember that Rosie was a feisty little girl when she lived on a plantation in Mississippi. But most of the black families were sharecroppers. The roads were dusty. The water came into the house from pails where they pumped the water and brought it in, or it was delivered in barrels. There was a wood-burning stove that heated the three-room house that cooked the food. Where behind that stove were sweet potatoes, collard greens, or white potatoes behind the stove. The toilet was outside just beyond the back door. So the first memories that Rosie had bounced between being a feisty little girl and a sick, sad little girl. She was her mother and father's first child together. Jake had two sons that lived with their mother in Edafina, Mississippi. And Rosie's oldest sister lived with her grandmother. So Georgia was the oldest, followed 2 years by Rosie, then J.K. a year later, but he died in that year. Then Willie and Lily, 2.5 years after Rosie, followed by Nathaniel, and last born in Mississippi, Ophelia, the last one born in Memphis. What is significant about listing all the children is what happens when you begin to apply psychological developmental stage theory. Well, at least Rosie. So most theories, and students, this is about as intellectual as I'm gonna get. Most people talk about stages, right? And they talk infant, first year. Some even start before you're born, toddler years, childhood years, adolescence and adult. And Erickson has 8 stages. And I wanted to highlight Erickson in part because it may be that some of these will begin to influence, some of this maybe influences what happened to Rosie, I don't know. But trust and mistrust and empathy up to 1 year. So trust with a warm response from a caretaker. And I highlight caretaker because I want you to notice that when we start talking about poverty. Autonomy and doubt in the toddler age. Autonomous if caregivers encourage independence, otherwise doubt. Initiative and guilt in preschool. If parents do not encourage initiative, the kids will feel guilt. I want you to pay attention to that when children have to do a lot of work when they're children. Industry and inferiority in the early school years. They will have inferiority feelings if the peer environment is hostile. And what did the children say to Rosie when she was a little girl? So black and ugly. Identity and hope confusion in adolescence. Self-identity is significant during adolescence. And then intimacy and isolation in early childhood. Those who cannot establish relationships or intimacy are prone to be socially isolated. And then generativity and you adult see stagnation. They're all studying adult development and aging, and you know, they use words like stagnation and decline. So stagnation, we're all stagnant. I just want y'all to. So, what happened with Rosie? And so, the very first year of her life, remember that a brother was born who died when he was a kid, and so there was a sense of loss. But still, Rosie played with her brothers. And for those of you who have sensitive ears, don't worry about it, but the feisty Rosie. Those two little boys and Rosie had a peeing contest off of the porch that high. And Rosie thought she won and still believes she won. The next story is Rosie acting out with a neighbor down the road a piece. Georgia, who's 2 years older, and by now Rosie is 5-ish, Georgia is in the field helping to chop and pick cotton. Rosie is at home taking care of the children. But there was a neighbor down the road a piece that must have tried to get Rosie to do something right. Feisty Rosie. But you can't tell me what to do, so she turned around and pat her butt at her. And when Georgia came home, she said, don't worry, I'm not going to tell Matilda. We'll kill that lady. We'll feed her some ants, and she'll die, and Matilda would never know. But, of course, Georgia went right to the field and told Matilda. And then the lady came down and told Rosie, and Rosie's sweeping at the back door. And I tell you that because this little girl is sweeping the house. Rosie knew she was in trouble when she heard the lady telling her mom. And sure enough, she called her out, laid her across her lap, and whipped her right there in front of the lady. Sad, Rosie. There was no one to save her. So this little girl felt autonomous, independent, and fear all at the same time. So another story with this little girl, Rosie and her brother Willie, getting typhoid fever. Because of the conditions that we lived in a place called Mississippi on a plantation where there were sharecroppers. Rosie was the most ill and so had to have a direct transfusion from her father. But what impressed the little girl was none of that. It was watching her mother stand up and sleep because though they could go to the hospital, there was no place for the mother to sit down. So she had to stand and sleep. This made Rosie wonder, how did she do that? And how come she didn't fall? And so the things about color and poverty began to creep in, because somehow Rosie knew she could never date that little cute, light-skinned boy. She was not the right color, and she was too poor. The family moved to Memphis when Jake was accused of some crime. What Rosie remembers is the white sheriff coming and talking to her mother with such disrespect, and her mom just standing strong. But when he left, they had ice boxes, you know, refrigerated ice box. Her mother standing with her hand in her chin, looking out the window and tears rolling down her face. And Rosie looked on with fear and confusion. She'd never seen this woman cry. How does a child feel secure if the parent is crying? The child may now begin to believe that her world is not safe. When the family was poor and living on a farm, they were an entire unit. In Memphis, the family seemed to slip into urban poverty. Segregation was profound, alcoholism and abuse. The intersection of poverty and race is profound in this country. You know how it is here in Akron or in Canada. I've met a lot of Canadians since I've been here. Rose's life began to be more complicated. Three more children were added to the mix. And I told you about the salary and that it didn't always cover what the family needed. Jake began to drink and began to become abusive. Madhu would run away from the abuse. She'd take the older daughter and leave the rest. And remember, Rosie was the oldest, and she didn't understand it. She felt responsible for the younger children, but she felt abandoned. And one day, when Madhu had run away and Rosie was 10, maybe, she decided, sitting on some steps, that she would never, ever love anybody enough to hurt that much when they left. But she kept trying to be a good girl, because she sometimes had to pay the bills. Thought if she paid the bills well, maybe her parents wouldn't fight. So we start thinking about Erikson's developmental theory and how a young girl grows up. But the lack of shoes and clothes did two things for Rosie. So when on the way to school, the children would call her black and ugly, Rosie said, well, what would happen if I got a dollar every time they call me black and ugly? And so then she started looking forward to being called black and ugly, because at the end of 1 week, she could buy herself a pair of black patent leather shoes, and she was cool. I guess you would call that resilience. And while it got it through her days, inferiority began to creep in, because she heard how little colored children weren't as smart as little white children, although she didn't interact with any of them until she went to college. She did learn it was a lie, but she didn't know at the time. Her world was segregated. And it's interesting that it was not whether or not she was smart or not, but it was the poverty that caused the shame. It was the poverty. Have you ever been ashamed because you were poor? When I give talks about poverty afterwards, people come up and whisper to me that they were poor. They still don't want to say it out loud. That other significant thing about being poor was Rosie building that wall around her heart, not wanting the abandonment, and then forgetting that the wall was there. So when she went off to college, she never felt homesick. And when as a teenager, all those girls carrying on about, Aretha Franklin and, you know, respect and I never loved a man and all that stuff. Rosie would pretend she knew what those girls were carrying on about, but she had no idea what in the world were they carrying on about, because her heart was walled off. So in that backdrop with poverty, it's probably a part of what helped me to want to think about poverty. Every year, the Census Bureau adjusts what is poverty in the United States. And where I go to is starting here with a family of four. 27,000, this was for last year. And this year it looks like this, a family of four, $30,000 a year. When you're in deep poverty, it's half that. There is no regard for where you live in the country. And so this is the poverty rate if you're in Memphis, Tennessee, or if you're in San Francisco, if you're here in Akron. That's what it is. when you look around the world and you see that there are 220 million people, and these numbers change, who want to work but are unemployed. When you see that nearly a billion people live on $2 a day or less, I find it unacceptable. And everywhere in the world, this number remains true, that 75% of the people living in poverty are women and children, 75%. In the United States, this number rarely changes. About 40 million people live in poverty, and 46% of them live in deep poverty. Always, that is about 12% of the people in the United States who live in poverty. Richest country in the world, and we allow that to happen. And some of you know what is happening with the debt ceiling and what those negotiations are. I lean left, by the way. I lean toward my heart. So when you hear some of my comments, you know which way I go. You know, when we look at poverty, though, usually the image we get, though, is of Black people. And there are some discrepancies. Oh, this is what COVID did. It did reduce the number in high income, but look what it did to poverty. And it just kicked that number right up. We helped some with what we gave in the country, but it was devastating. Children in poverty before COVID, children in poverty after COVID. Lots of children live in poverty. And when you look at, the numbers get really bad when you look at access to education, housing, nutrition. Billion children worldwide are multidimensionally poor. Children from the poorest household die at twice the rate of their better off peers. That's what poverty does for us. And so I have to wonder about it. This is the Hispanic population of Black. One of the things you're gonna find, all the charts don't have all the races and ethnicities on it, but they never change. It's gonna always be that the worst off in our country are going to be Black and indigenous people, Native Americans. I don't know why they didn't put Hispanics on this chart, but just looking at overall poverty rates by group from the United States. And these changes, Asians in the United States usually don't fare quite as badly. What I like about this chart is that if I had started this talk and say, envision a poor person, what I find is that most of the time people envision somebody Black. But isn't this interesting that people who have not enough to eat, when you look at it, that number, 3.4 million Black people, 3.2 million Hispanic people, and guess what? When you add them together, they don't come up to how many white people go to bed hungry at night. But we don't like to tell people that because we don't want to engender any sympathy for it. That's my philosophy. That's my Mahatma Gandhi. Poverty is the worst form of violence. The criminal justice system. We look at poor people. Poverty is the best predictor of involvement in the criminal justice system. And look at that. We find that people who go to jail, particularly those that go more than once a year, are disproportionately likely to have incomes under $10,000 a year. What does that tell us? And then you look at incarceration, don't you love it? Look at that. It just goes away. Now, Andrew, it could be because of that article you sent me. Henry Garrett, one of our presidents, who says that, you know, those Black people, they just smaller brains, can't think, they're good at dancing, of course. And maybe that's why. This is incarceration rates around the world. Okay, you see the place that has the biggest incarceration rate? Louisiana. Now look how far down we have to find to get to another country. Oh, I meant to point out where Ohio was. Oh, there's Ohio. Fiji is less than Ohio though. You folk in Ohio, y'all gotta do better. I didn't point out Tennessee where I'm from because we're much higher than y'all are. And poverty, you know, we talked about social class, but I was impressed that we didn't start talking about poverty until about 10 years ago. And I now have my first book on poverty written by a psychologist. Heather Bullock was in my poverty work group when I was president of APA, and she just said, so I'm going to use it for my class. This looks the same. I changed the year sometimes, but it looks the same. And I always like to tell you all about my hometown, my state, my city, so that if I talk about yours, you'll know that mine is probably worse off. So this was in 2020, and it changes very little. And this is looking at the overall poverty rates. And you see what I told you is true, that when you look, this is about how it looks, and you see indigenous people, what their rates are. Why is it that in Memphis, indigenous people are so much better off? Anybody know why? They aren't any indigenous people. Yeah, that's why. I know. You put these numbers up there and you say, oh, they're doing better. In fact, I when I realized, I said, I don't know any indigenous people in Memphis. I finally met one. I was going to Jenny Craig after my weight was getting more than I wanted it to be. And she was Pony. And she didn't even know how to say hello in Pony. I said, the next time I come, I'm going to show you. So I went, Googled it, came over there, used the internet to show me how to pronounce words and whatnot, and I took it to her, and she was very grateful. But we wipe out the civilizations and make it unacceptable to know your native language. So it's the same in Memphis. We are a black city. And so, of course, we have high rates of poverty. Latinos are right there. We've had more Latinos move in, and they are poor. What was interesting to me is looking at Knoxville. Anybody follow football in here? That's where the Tennessee Vols play. So you know that Tennessee Vols play there. It shocked me, and I thought, 100,000 people go to Neyland Stadium every game. And I looked at these poverty rates and I said, what? How can they have that much poverty in Knoxville? And sometimes this rate for white individuals in Knoxville really and truly looks like the rate for what it is for black folk. But this year, it wasn't so bad. And then I said, oh, I wonder how it is. And so Gail, your city, Cleveland, you're number one. And then I decided to look at Akron to see, and it doesn't change very much. So in Akron, among the white population, 18% in poverty, black 32%, and so on. Hmm? Oh, that's okay. Than you would have thought? Yeah. One of the things that I find sometimes is that wherever I go around the United States is that it looks pretty much the same. Sometimes we'll think that it's better up north. It isn't. It looks pretty much the same. We have a national problem with poverty in the United States. And it doesn't change. Now, when you count up absolute numbers, then you begin to see these numbers look different. So those percentages look different, but it's because the people within that group goes down. So I am an NPR junkie. Any other NPR people in the house? Yeah, I love NPR. So I was listening to Poverty Mythbusters in 2016. And so they were doing a segment on pulling yourself up by your bootstraps. And so I actually now have a closet in my house that was big as some of the rooms I live in. And that's pretty cool. And so I'm doing sit-up in my closet. For real, my closet is probably 6x9, but that's almost as big as one of the rooms we live in. And so they were saying around, Chetty and Hendren researchers saying, so their research showed that around the world, you know, your chances if you're in the bottom quintile of rising to the top quintile about 15%. In the United States, your chances, if you're in the bottom quintile economically, your chances are greatest reaching the upper quintile are in San Jose, California, and it's 12.9%. And the thing that caught my attention, because they mentioned Memphis, and they said your chances are 3% if you live in Memphis. I immediately ran and grabbed my husband. I said, okay, we're miracles. You know, but when you look at it, when you look at the face of poverty, we don't like to look at these faces, though. We'd rather look at a face like mine. But this is what poverty looks like. And you know, the amazing thing about poverty is that all of us, well, no, I'll say you all are probably different than I am, but I will get subject to some of the same biases that people have. And I think somebody's trying to scam me because they're poor. And I tell this story because I want you to know that I'm no different than anybody else. And I was in Target one day, and a woman's coming out. She was walking with two little children, 4 or 5 years old. And she comes up to me as I'm in my car, and she says, do you have some money to give me? I need to feed my children. And I'm thinking, the nerve of this woman trying to scam me and using her children too. I said, smart Rose, I don't have any money, but I have this box of crackers. So I gave her a box of crackers. Ninth in my shame. When I drove off, she's opened that box of crackers and was feeding her children. Now I keep money. I don't care if they're trying to scam me. I don't care. I'm going to give it. A lot of mental health barriers. But you know, it's interesting. What data shows is that there aren't really significant difference between the mental illnesses that people have based on. But what is different is the distance, the stigma, and sometimes, you know, I got to talk in Kuwait about poverty. And, you know, the Kuwaiti citizens all have money. And now the immigrants don't, what the Kuwaiti citizens do, because of all that oil money, they take care of them. But still, stigma, though, about mental health. Biases about it. And poor people have them, too, just like anybody else. When you have better wealth, you know, you get better health, better outcomes. Poverty in education. I love it that they give tests to people. And yet, by the time children reach fourth grade, poor children are 26 points behind their wealthier counterparts. And what we're doing more and more is that in public schools is where poor kids go. They go to poor. Part of the reason why states then want to say, well, let's give some of the tax money to private schools. Poor kids are going. Poverty is bad for your health. An estimated 7 billion people remain at risk for tropical diseases. 2020, 1.5 million people died from tuberculosis. Poor people, 50% greater risk for disease. And so I'll tell you another story. So, this is to wake y'all up if y'all gotten sleeping. So I married a man who had 4 children when we got married. His daughter, Michelle, was about 10 or so. So Michelle, though, later on grew up and was poor. She got married at 18 and divorced. And then she had, one child, then she had a total of 5. By the time she got to the 5th child, she was living in Jacksonville. She was living in Memphis. And one day, she had a baby who wasn't a year old. She called her dad. She said, I've been to the emergency room. She was crying. She called from a phone. And she said, I'm sick. And they're sending me home. And so her dad, the physician, said, he says, go back in that emergency room. Go back in there. And he called him with you. And he called. And he told him that his daughter was sick and that they had better take care of her. And so they looked at her more closely and they put her in the hospital. Called him back and said, Mr. Davis, we're so sorry. Your daughter needs a heart. In 2 weeks, she was dead. It's what poverty does for you. She was a poor black woman with 5 kids. The other thing that has changed in our country with the loss of manufacturing jobs is the loss of the blue-collar aristocracy, so that now in some counties, for the first time, starting in 2015, white men are dying earlier than black men. And so I wonder, what kind of country is this? You know who the stars are in this country? White men. How do we allow them to get you? having to have deaths from despair. I don't get it. Black women, 3 times more likely to die than white women in childbirth. Oh my goodness. And this is out of Canada, by the way. Poverty is a risk factor. It's a great story. And they linked all of these, this study linked all of these, cancer, diabetes, toxic stress, mental illness, all that with poverty. New immigrant women, indigenous people, LGBTQ+, are among the highest risk groups. If an otherwise healthy 35-year-old comes to your office without risk factors for diabetes other than living in poverty, you need to consider screening for diabetes. It's there. We know that. Premature deaths from treatable conditions. So it's going to life expectancy. In every state, that's why don't start talking to me about the South and the North. In every state, Black people are more likely to die early from treatable conditions. In every state in the United States, every one of them. Is that a coincidence? And it's not unusual for people to be poor, but it's hard to stay out of poverty. You rise above it and go back in. Now, this is why I wanted you to remember the slide about the caregivers. Growing up emotionally healthy, what does a child need? This is from Eric Jensen. A strong, reliable primary caregiver. Remember every time I put caregiver up there? Safe, predictable, stable environments. 10 to 20 hours each week of harmonious, reciprocal interaction. That's between the caregiver and the kid. Enrichment through personalized, increasingly complex activity. Tell me, how does a poor caregiver do that? Where do they get that 10 to 20 hours? And then we blame parents. And that is, and I am not saying that parents don't have work to do. I am saying that we have not trained them, and we don't tell them, and we don't show them how to do it. And because of the demands on their time, almost everybody in my family, nobody doesn't, most of them are poor, they'll end up 2 or 3 jobs. Where do they find? I find that most times they're just mad. So how do they do 10 to 20 hours of harmonious? Yeah. I don't get it. I didn't get that either. Yeah. Oh, boy. So, and then I just like to put that up there because people think, people in the cities, the people in the city who are poor, but actually in rural rates, the rates are higher. And it's not unusual when you go out into rural areas to see that somebody maybe is getting their electricity from a neighbor, they're getting their Wi-Fi from a neighbor. One of the things, though, is that when I read about a woman, though, who was poor in rural area, you know, she didn't want to go get, because we make people shame about going to get benefits. Go get some food that the government has helped you with. And she wouldn't go until she realized that her children were just hungry, and she just had to go. Why would anybody have to feel that badly about going to get food for their children? I don't get it. That's why I told you I have questions. I got no answers. And out in rural areas, the thing that is hard too is that we have so many food deserts, and a million children in this country don't live anywhere near a pediatrician. I'm gonna rush through if I get to come back, because I want to stop, because I want you all to ask me questions. I'm almost at my 45 minutes. Okay, so, you know, these are just attitudes. Oh, I did want to mention this since I'm at Akron, is that this research is done by the Hope Center at Temple, and they look at colleges around the country. And we think that college students aren't poor, but 36% of college students are food insecure. I want you to know that at Akron, so that you make sure you do. 40% can't pay for a balanced meal. 36% are housing insecure. 9% are completely homeless. When I was a vice president, I would meet with just random groups of students at graduation time. And I remember this very handsome young Black guy. He wore a suit every day, and he met my office for graduation. I learned he'd been couch surfing the entire time, but he looked good. At community colleges, 27% of both food and housing insecure. So we can change it. We can talk to people about poverty. This is too little. So if anybody wants it, I will share it with you. But here's one of the things. I love this country because we can do dialectical thinking in this country. Think about two things at the same time. Most Americans, majority of Americans believe living standards for the poorest Americans are an important national issue. Poverty is mostly due to external circumstances, not lack of effort by poor people. The government should do more to reduce the gap between the rich and the poor. Government programs for poor people are a critical safety net that helps get people back on their foot. Income and wealth inequality hold back economic growth. An increased minimum wage, improved education, and college access are important anti-poverty approaches that should be adopted. Americans believe that. Americans believe poor people have become too dependent on government assistance programs. Still, it is not the responsibility of the government to reduce the differences in income between people with high and low income. Believe poverty is an acceptable part of our economic system that does not need to be fixed. Are unaware of most of the structural causes and hold negative racial stereotypes and beliefs relating to poverty. They believe all those things at the same time. Isn't that amazing? I love America. But what do you have to do? You have to begin to show how we're interconnected. You've got to tell stories. You can't give people a bunch of slides like I'm doing. You got to tell them stories. So that little girl, Rosie, what makes a difference? I think all of it made me want to make a difference. We have to learn that we are here to serve each other. We have to learn that we can be free and good. And how do we make that dare? I'm going to skip all of that. So what happened to Rosie? Everything that happened on these slides happened to different members of the family. I have one brother that they took advantage of. He was winning football player, state champion, and shot put. My youngest brother went to his high school graduation. He had 3.5 GPA. Yeah, very impressive, huh? And so he was trying to write thank you notes to people. And he said to me, he and I sitting at a table, he says, Rosie, how do you spell sad? Excuse me? How do you spell sad? He couldn't read 3.5 GPA. He had scholarships to Nebraska, Oklahoma. Ohio State had recruited him, brought him up there. The summer before he was supposed to go to college, though, he stepped in a hole and tore up his knee. So y'all know what my brother is? A crack addict. But what happens and how did Rosie manage? I had sisters, professors, and most importantly, great friends. I'll tell you one more story about that walled-off heart. So I was married, living in student family housing in Ohio. Alvinia had sung at my wedding. I met her at Ohio State. Then we met Barbara and Gail. And then Alvinia got married and moved to, of all places, Mississippi. And so I'm walking down the street. Now, I got married. I knew I shouldn't have, but I had gotten married. I'm walking down the street one day, and I'm feeling some sort of way. You ever felt some sort of way? And I think, what is wrong with me? And I realized I missed Alvinia. A crack began to form in that wall around my heart. I think it's what allows me to do the work that I do now. Because even when I went to Lisbon, y'all, I just got back, which is why I'm tired. But in the fall, I had been, Tyree Nichols, y'all heard about Tyree Nichols in Memphis, y'all heard about all. I was saying, is there any place in the world where Black people from the United States are welcome? And I used my best friend Google. And Lisbon came up, so I said, I'm going to Lisbon. I hadn't had a vacation in 6 years. I told my husband, I'm going to Lisbon. He said, I'm going too. And I was talking to Barbara, and Barbara said, I'm going too. I said, okay, I'm going. And Lisbon is great. And we got a hotel up there on Liver Die Day, and it looked rich. And yet, lying on the richest street in there, poverty. You don't get to not see it if you're willing to look. So, I just want you to bring what you know to the fight against poverty. It won't just be money. You can't buy your way out of it. But you can do something about it. So here's what you can do. Understand poverty in your community. Get a vision that matches skills, whatever you can do. Do something. The community scientists are the people who live in the community, by the way. Go ask them. Don't just do something for them. Just like you all aren't just going to just serve old people. You're going to go ask them what they need. Get a plan. Be an advocate. Think creatively. Believe that there's enough. And then I want to end here on this quote. When I was at Fatima, you know, it's a big old Catholic church, a lot of tourists. I was reading some of the one of the quotes that I read. How do I react to the needs that I see all around me? To be sure, you cannot resolve all the problems in the world. From Rosie. Yet you can begin with the problems closest to you. Someone once told Mother Teresa, what you're doing is a mere drop in the ocean. And she replied, but if I didn't do it, that ocean would have one drop left. I beg you to be a drop in the ocean. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Well, thank you. Thank you. So,
we have time for questions.
I'm almost right on time, only 1 minute over. So, who has a question? You can ask me a question about anything at all, by the way. You can even ask me what I do on date night with my husband. Very easy, it's nothing, but I mean, you could. But you certainly can ask whatever you like. So, who has a question? You know I'm a professor, so I call on people if they don't ask a question. Oh.
So, when you describe the start of your life, you describe anybody in the first person that makes you feel.
Make me have real worth. You know, honestly, I would probably, maybe even my mother, maybe. My mother, even as a little girl, when they would fight, even when I was 10, she didn't want to take my dad's money because she was mad. Well, she'd give it to me to go pay the bills. So she knew that I could do all the things that I could do. I've been blessed to have lots of people who took an interest in me, my early teachers. Though we were poor, the black teachers at that time looked out for the children. And so they would, and they insisted that I do the work that I need to do. Even in high school, my prom date was arranged by the teachers. So I went to school, you know, I was third in my class, so I went to the prom with the valedictorian of the class. We didn't choose it, they chose it. So there were people all along. In graduate school, I give lots of credit to Bruce Walsh. I see that he donates because he looked out for me. He just say, Rosie, it's time for us to finish your dissertation. Rosie, it's time to write an article. Rosie, it's time to do a book chapter. And I say, okay. So I don't know, my friends, when I have tough times, it's the nurturance of my biological and my chosen sisters that I turn to the most. Yes.
Has religion had an impact
on your life?
Heck yeah. I'm the Black Baptist in the church. Let me tell you. I mean, we couldn't even cross our legs like that for dancing. And I was such a good girl I wasn't one of those girls who had sex when I was a teenager, because that was wrong. My first job was as an assistant professor, this is post-PhD, Ohio Dominican College here in Ohio. And they had a celebration for one of the faculty's birthday, 10 o'clock in the morning, and they had wine. I was sure they were all going to hell. No, I still, though, am a woman of faith to this very day. And I always tell psychologists that you're free to think you should prescribe medicine for me, because I do hear the voice of God. And I will hear that message. So, for example, when we were having the war in Iran, and I'm walking and wondering, why are we having these fights? I don't get it. And the voice was clear as a bell, said, there is fear that there is not enough. The fear that there is not enough. People lack faith that there is enough. So I still do. And I had some experiences where, when my son was 16 and he had scoliosis surgery, and it was just supposed to be out of the hospital in 3 days, 10 days later. My son is in the hospital, but they won't let him go because he couldn't have a BM. And so I'm outside his room and I'm distressed. And the voice says, Rosie, go in and lay hands on Akil's body and he'll go home tomorrow. So I went in and I said, may I pray for you? So I prayed over his whole body. And then I went home. My husband spent the night. I came back the next day. Akil was sitting there and said, hey, Mom. Look in the bathroom. He had saved his poop for me. And he went home. So, yeah. Yes. Well, that's such a good story. So, when I graduated from undergrad, Now, when I was 15, I did kind of think I wanted to be a psychiatrist, but I went to a park, you know, and I saw these people out there doing this. I said, what is wrong with these people? And it scared me to death. I said, oh, no, I don't want to do that. So I didn't know. I mean, we were taught that we could be a secretary, a teacher, a nurse. I didn't like nursing stuff. So when I went to undergrad, I loved history, and I wanted to be a history major, all you historians. And so one professor, I guess he was my advisor, said to me, well, history teachers are a dime a dozen. You're never going to get a job. I said, well, then what am I going to do? He says, what do you like to do? I said, I like helping people. He said, well, major in sociology. I said, okay. And so I majored. And so when I took the first class, I said, this is boring. He said, it'll get better in your upper division. So I graduated bored, and so I still didn't know what to do. So I went to work in Chicago after I got done, and then some of my friends had gone to Ohio State, and so I started applying. Maybe I'll go in counseling. Maybe I could be a high school counselor. So I applied, and let me tell you, people were so kind to me. For those people who admit people, they said, why do you want to go? I said, I want to buy my mother a house. I can't believe they admitted me to graduate school on this stuff. So I got in. I didn't even know which program I was in at Ohio State. It turns out I was in the SPA program. And in the SPA program, you could be in student personnel assistance. I don't know if they still call it that, but, you know, people who help with sororities and fraternities. Or you could be in what is now clinical mental health. Back then it was counseling guidance, or you could be in the counseling psychology program. For some reason, I took most of my courses in counseling psychology. Don't ask me why. I did. David Shaw was on the counseling psychology faculty, and he said to me, Rosie, I think you'd make a good counseling psychologist. I think you should apply. He says, have you folders sent over from the College of Education,
and come talk to me and I'll tell you how to fix your application so you get in. Because at that time, Ohio State accepted 4 or 5 students a year. Well, I did have my folder sent over, but I never did put an application. But I got a note saying, contingent upon finishing your master's, you are admitted to the counseling psychology PhD program. And so that was in August, and I was going to finish in December. But I was hanging out with Albina with these hip hugger pants and these that, and we partied every weekend. So in January, I said, I'm not ready to go to work. I'm having a good time. So I stayed in school. And then all of a sudden, I was done with courses and had to take my exam, which I broke in high, out in high, preparing for my exam. Professor was very kind, said, we better hurry up and give you this exam, or you're going to be one big blister. Very empathic response. And so when I finished that and was working with Bruce Walsh on my dissertation, because I had all kind of wild ideas. He said, yeah, you could do that, or you could do this work I'm doing. He was doing some work with John Holland and vocational studies. So I did that. So when I had passed my comprehensive exams working on a dissertation, I said, oh my God, I guess I'm going to get a PhD. So that's how I got a PhD. I told you guys anything. I'm blessed, and a lot of things fell my way. And I think I'm called to do the work that I'm called to do. I'm called to talk to you about poverty tonight. My hope is that you will answer that call and do something about it. Kathy's up, so I think we're through.
Thank you.